This the Tathagata knows and more, but he is not attached to that knowledge. And being thus unattached, he has experienced for himself perfect peace, and having truly understood the arising and passing away of feelings, their attraction and peril, and the deliverance from them, the Tathagata is liberated without remainder. There are amongst other matters profound, hard to see, hard to understand, peaceful, excellent, beyond mere thought, subtle, to be experienced by the wise, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. And what are these matters? There are among some ascetics and Brahmins who are partly eternalists and partly non-eternalists, who proclaim the partial eternity and the partial non-eternity of the self and the world in four ways. On what grounds? There comes a time, monks, sooner or later, after a long period, when this world contracts. At the time of contraction, beings are mostly reborn in the Abhasara Brahma world, and there they dwell, mind-made, feeding on delight, self-luminous, moving through the air, glorious, and they stay like that for a very long time. But the time comes, sooner or later, after a long period, when this world begins to expand. In this expanding world, an empty palace of Brahma appears. And then one being, from exhaustion of his lifespan or of his merits, falls from the Abhasara world and arises in the empty Brahma palace. And there he dwells, mind-made, feeding on delight, self-luminous, moving through the air, glorious, and he stays like that for a very long time. Stop here for a moment. This Abhasara Brahma world refers to the second jhana heavens, when the world ends, then the beings are reborn. They practice meditation and they are reborn in the second jhana heaven, and after a long time, this being in the second jhana heaven, he falls down from there to the first jhana heaven, which is the Brahma world. No. Then in this being who has been alone for so long, there arises unrest, discontent and worry, and he thinks, oh, if only some other beings would come here. And other beings, from exhaustion of their lifespan or of their merit, fall from the Abhasara world and arise in the Brahma palace as companions for this being. And there they dwell, mind-made, etc., and they stay like that for a very long time. And then monks, that being who first arose there thinks, I am Brahma, the great Brahma, the conqueror, the unconquered, the all-seeing, the all-powerful Lord, the maker and creator, ruler, appointer and orderer, father of all that have been and shall be. These beings were created by me. How so? Because I first had this thought, oh, if only some other beings would come here. That was my wish. And then those beings came into this existence. But those beings who arose subsequently think, this friend is Brahma, great Brahma, the conqueror, the unconquered, the all-seeing, the all-powerful, the Lord, maker and creator, ruler, appointer and orderer, father of all that have been and shall be. How so? We have seen that he was here first and that we arose after him. And this being that arose first is longer lived, more beautiful and more powerful than they are. And it may happen that some being falls from that realm and arises in this world. Having arisen in this world, he goes forth from the household life into homelessness. Having gone forth, he, by means of effort, exertion, application, earnestness, and right attention, attains to such a degree of mental concentration that he thereby recalls his last existence, but he recalls none before that, and he thinks, that Brahma, he made us, and he is permanent, stable, eternal, not subject to change, the same forever and ever. But we who were created by that Brahma, we are impermanent, unstable, short-lived, fated to fall away, and we have come to this world. This is the first case whereby some ascetics and Brahmins are partly eternalists and partly non-eternalists. And what is the second way? There are among certain devas called corrupted by pleasure. They spend an excessive amount of time addicted to merriment, play and enjoyment, so that their mindfulness is dissipated. And by the dissipation of mindfulness, those beings fall from that state. And it can happen that a being, having fallen from that state, arises in this world. Having arisen in this world, he goes forth from the household of life into homelessness. Having gone forth, he by means of effort, exertion, etc., recalls his last existence, but recalls none before that. He thinks, those reverend devas who are not corrupted by pleasure do not spend an excessive amount of time addicted to merriment, play and enjoyment. Thus their mindfulness is not dissipated, and so they do not fall from that state. They are permanent, stable, eternal, not subject to change, the same forever and ever. But we who are corrupted by pleasure spend an excessive amount of time addicted to merriment, play and enjoyment. Thus we, by the dissipation of mindfulness, have fallen from that state. We are impermanent, unstable, short-lived, fated to fall away, and we have come to this world. This is the second case. And what is the third way? There are monks, certain devas, called corrupted in mind. They spend an excessive amount of time regarding each other with envy. By this means, their minds are corrupted. On account of their corrupted minds, they become weary in body and mind, and they fall from that place. And it can happen that a being, having fallen from that state, arises in this world. He recalls his last existence, but recalls none before that. He thinks, those reverend devas who are not corrupted in mind do not spend an excessive amount of time regarding each other with envy. They do not become corrupted in mind or weary in body and mind, and so they do not fall from that state. They are permanent, stable, eternal. But we who are corrupted in mind are impermanent, unstable, short-lived, fated to fall away, and we have come to this world. This is the third case. And what is the fourth way? Here, a certain ascetic or Brahmin is a logician, a reasoner, hammering it out by reason, following his own line of thought. He argues, whatever is called eye or ear or nose or tongue or body, that is impermanent, unstable, non-eternal, liable to change. But what is called thought or mind or consciousness, that is a self that is permanent, stable, eternal, not subject to change, the same forever and ever. This is the fourth case. These are the four ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins are partly eternalists and partly non-eternalists. Whatever ascetics and Brahmins proclaim the partial eternity and the partial non-eternity of the self and the world, they do so on one or other of these four grounds. There is no other way. This monks, the Tathagata understands, these viewpoints are grasped and adhered to will lead to such and such destinations in another world. This the Tathagata knows and more. But he is not attached to that knowledge. And being thus unattached, he has experienced for himself perfect peace. And having truly understood the arising and passing away of feelings, their attraction and peril, and the deliverance from them, the Tathagata is liberated without remainder. These monks are those other matters, profound, hard to see, hard to understand, peaceful, excellent, beyond mere thought, subtle, to be experienced by the wise, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. Stop here for a moment. You see here, under 2.15, the Buddha says, the Tathagata, the Buddha knows this and much more, but he is not attached to that knowledge. And so he experiences perfect peace. He understands the arising and passing way of feelings, the attraction and peril and the deliverance from them. So feelings is something that gives us a lot of suffering if we don't know how to control our feelings. All the dukkha, all the suffering in the world is only because of being unable to control our feelings. So if we cultivate our mind and have a strong mind, only then can we have a mind that is solid as a rock that will not move. Because external conditions always move our mind and emotions change. But if our mind is strong, then we are not moved by external conditions, especially what the Buddha calls the eight winds that try to move us. There are monks, some ascetics and Brahmins who are finitists and infinitists, and who proclaim the finitude and infinitude of the world on four grounds. What are they? Here, a certain ascetic or Brahmin, has by means of effort, etc., attained to such a state of concentration that he dwells perceiving the world as finite. He thinks, this world is finite and bounded by a circle. How so? Because I have attained to such a state of concentration that I dwell perceiving the world as finite. Therefore, I know that this world is finite and bounded by a circle. This is the first case. And what is the second way? Here, a certain ascetic or Brahmin has attained to such a state of concentration that he dwells perceiving the world as infinite. He thinks, this world is infinite and unbounded. Those ascetics and Brahmins who say it is finite and bounded are wrong. How so? Because I have attained to such a state of concentration that I dwell perceiving the world as infinite. Therefore, I know that this world is infinite and unbounded. This is the second case. And what is the third way? Here, a certain ascetic or Brahmin has attained to such a state of consciousness that he dwells perceiving the world as finite up and down and infinite across. He thinks, the world is finite and infinite. Those ascetics and Brahmins who say it is finite are wrong, and those who say it is infinite are wrong. How so? Because I have attained to such a state of concentration that I dwell perceiving the world as finite, up and down, and infinite across. Therefore, I know that the world is both finite and infinite. This is the third case. And what is the fourth case? Here, a certain ascetic or Brahmin is a logician, a reasoner. Hammering it out by reason, he argues, this world is neither finite nor infinite. Those who say it is finite are wrong, and those who say it is infinite, and those who say it is finite and infinite. This world is neither finite nor infinite. This is the fourth case. These are the four ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins are finitists and infinitists and proclaim the finitude and infinitude of the world on four grounds. There is no other way. This monk, the Tathagata, understands. These viewpoints are thus grasped and adhered to will lead to such and such destinations in another world. These monks are those other matters, profound, hard to see, hard to understand, peaceful, excellent, beyond mere thought, subtle, to be experienced by the wise, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. There are monks, some ascetics and Brahmins who are ill-rigorous. When asked about this or that matter, they resort to evasive statements and they wriggle like eels on four grounds. What are they? In this case, there is an ascetic or Brahmin who does not in truth know whether a thing is good or bad. He thinks, I do not in truth know whether this is good or whether it is bad. Not knowing which is right, I might declare that is good or that is bad, and that might be a lie. And that would distress me. If I were distressed, that would be a hindrance to me. Thus, fearing to lie, abhorring to lie, he does not declare a thing to be good or bad. But when asked about this or that matter, he resorts to evasive statements and wriggles like an eel. I don't say this. I don't say that. I don't say it is otherwise. I don't say it is not. I don't say it is. I don't say it is not. I don't not say it is not. That is the first case. What is the second way? Here, an ascetic or Brahmin does not in truth know whether a thing is good or bad. He thinks, I might declare that is good or that is bad, and I might feel desire or lust or hatred or aversion. If I felt desire, lust, hatred or aversion, that would be attachment on my part. If I felt attachment, that would distress me. And if I were distressed, that would be a hindrance to me. Thus, fearing attachment, abhorring attachment, he resorts to evasive statements. This is the second case. What is the third way? Here, an ascetic or Brahmin does not in truth know whether a thing is good or bad. He thinks, I might declare that is good or that is bad. But there are some ascetics and Brahmins who are wise, skillful, practiced debaters, like archers who can split hairs, who go around destroying others' views with their wisdom. And they might cross-examine me, demanding my reasons and arguing. I might not be able to reply. Not being able to reply would distress me. And if I were distressed, that would be a hindrance to me. Thus, fearing debate, abhorring debate, resorts to evasive statements. This is the third case. What is the fourth way? Here, an ascetic or Brahmin is dull and stupid. Because of his dullness and stupidity, when he is questioned, he resorts to evasive statements and wriggles like an eel. If you ask me whether there is another world, If I thought so, I would say there is another world. But I don't say so, and I don't say otherwise, and I don't say it is not, and I don't say it, and I don't not say it is not. Is there another world? Is there both another world and no other world? Is there neither another world nor another world? Are there spontaneously born beings? Are there not? Are there both or neither? Does the Tathagata exist after death? Does he not exist after death? Does he both exist and not exist after death? Does he neither exist nor not exist after death? If I thought so, I would say so. I don't say it is not. This is the fourth case. These are the four ways in which those ascetics and Brahmins are ill-rigorous, resort to evasive statements. There is no other way. This monk, the Tathagata, understands. These viewpoints, thus grasped and adhered to, will lead to such and such destinations in another world. These monks are those other matters, profound, hard to see, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. There are monks, some ascetics and Brahmins, who are chance originationists, and who proclaim the chance origin of the world and the self on two grounds. What are they? There are monks, certain devas called unconscious, asanya. As soon as a perception arises in them, those devas fall from that realm. And it may happen that a being falls from that realm and arises in this world. He recalls his last existence, but none before that. He thinks, the self and the world have arisen by chance. How so? Before this, I did not exist. Now from not being, I have been brought to being. This is the first case. What is the second case? Here an ascetic or Brahmin is a logician, a reasoner. He hammers out his own opinion and declares, the self and the world have arisen by chance. This is the second case. These are the two ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins who are chance originists proclaim the chance origin of the self and the world. There is no other way. This monk, the Tathagata, understands. These monks are those other matters, profound, hard to see, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. And these monks are the 18 ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins are speculators about the past. There is no other way. This monk, the Tathagata, understands. There are monks and ascetics and Brahmins who are speculators about the future, having fixed views about the future, and who put forward various speculative theories about the future in 44 different ways. On what basis, on what grounds do they do so? There are monks, some ascetics and Brahmins, who proclaim a doctrine of conscious self-mortem survival, and do so in 16 different ways. On what basis? They declare that the self after death is healthy and conscious and material, or immaterial. Number 3, both material and immaterial. 4, neither material nor immaterial. 5, infinite. 6, 5, finite. 6, infinite. 7, both. 8, neither. 9, of uniform perception. 10, of varied perception. 11, of limited perception. 12, of unlimited perception. 13, wholly happy. 14, wholly miserable. 15, both. 16, neither. These are the 16 ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins proclaim a doctrine of conscious post-mortem survival. There is no other way. This monk, the Tathagata, understands. These monks are those other matters, profound, hard to see, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. There are monks, some ascetics and Brahmins who proclaim the doctrine of unconscious post-mortem survival, and they do so in 8 ways. On what basis? They declare that the self after death is healthy and unconscious, and 1, material, 2, immaterial, 3, both, 4, neither, 5, finite, 6, infinite, 7, both, 8, neither. These are the 8 ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins proclaim a doctrine of unconscious post-mortem survival. There is no other way. This monk, the Tathagata, understands. These monks are those other matters, profound, hard to see, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. There are some ascetics and Brahmins who declare a doctrine of neither conscious nor unconscious post-mortem survival, and they do so in 8 ways. On what basis? They declare that the self after death is healthy and neither conscious nor unconscious and one, material, two, immaterial, three, both, four, neither, five, finite, six, infinite, seven, both, eight, neither. These are the eight ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins proclaim a doctrine of neither conscious nor unconscious post-mortem survival. There is no other way. This monks, the Tathagata understands, these monks are those other matters profound, hard to see, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. There are monks, some ascetics and Brahmins, who are annihilationists, who proclaim their annihilation, destruction, and non-existence of beings, and they do so in seven ways. On what basis? Here, a certain ascetic or Brahmin declares and holds the view. Since this self is material, composed of the four great elements, the product of mother and father, at the breaking up of the body, it is annihilated and perishes and does not exist after death. This is the way in which this self is annihilated. That is how some proclaim the annihilation, destruction and non-existence of beings. Another says to him, "Sir, there is such a self as you say. I don't deny it. But that self is not wholly annihilated. There is another self, divine, material, belonging to the sense sphere, fed on real food. You don't know it or see it, but I do. It is this self that, at the breaking up of the body, perishes." Another says to him, "Sir, there is such a self as you say, I don't deny it, but that self is not wholly annihilated. There is another self, divine, material, mind-made, complete with all its parts, not defective in any sense organ. It is this self that at the breaking up of the body perishes." Another says to him, "Sir, there is such a self as you say. There is another self which by passing entirely beyond bodily sensations, by the disappearance of all sense of resistance, and by non-attraction to the perception of diversity, seeing that space is infinite, has realized the sphere of infinite space. It is this self that at the breaking up of the body perishes." Another says to him, "There is another self which by passing entirely beyond the sphere of infinite space, seeing that consciousness is infinite, has realized the sphere of infinite consciousness. It is this self that at the breaking up of the body perishes." Another says to him, "There is another self which by passing entirely beyond the sphere of infinite consciousness, seeing that there is no thing, has realized the sphere of no thingness. It is this self that at the breaking up of the body perishes." Another says to him, "Sir, there is such a self as you say, I don't deny it, but that self is not wholly annihilated. For there is another self, which by passing entirely beyond the sphere of nothingness and seeing, this is peaceful, this is sublime, has realized the sphere of neither perception nor non-perception. You don't know it or see it, but I do. It is this self that at the breaking up of the body is annihilated and perishes and does not exist after death. This is the way in which the self is completely annihilated. That is how some proclaim the annihilation, destruction and non-existence of beings. These are the seven ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins proclaim a doctrine of annihilation, destruction and non-existence of beings. And there is no other way. This monks, the Tathagata understands, these monks are those other matters, profound, hard to see, etc., which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. There are monks, some ascetics and Brahmins, who are proclaimers of Nibbana here and now, and who proclaim Nibbana here and now for an existent being in five ways. On what grounds? Here, a certain ascetic or Brahmin declares and holds the view, in as far as this self, being furnished and endowed with the fivefold sense pleasures, indulges in them, then that is when the self realizes the highest Nibbana here and now. So some proclaim it. Another says to him, "Sir, there is such a self as you say, I don't deny it, but that is not where the self realizes the highest Nibbana here and now. Why so? Because, sir, sense desires are impermanent, painful, and subject to change. And from their change and transformation, there arise sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief, and distress. But when this self, detached from sense desires, detached from unwholesome states, enters and abides in the first jhana, which is accompanied by thought directed and sustained, and the delight and happiness born of detachment. That is when the self realizes the highest Nibbana here and now. Another says to him, Sir, there is such a self as you say, but that is not when the self attains Nibbana. How so? Because on account of thought directed and sustained, that state is considered gross. But when the self, by the subsiding of thought directed and sustained, enters and abides in the second jhana with inner tranquility and oneness of mind, or unity of mind, or one-pointedness of mind, which is free from thought directed and sustained, and is born of concentration, and is accompanied by delight and joy or happiness, that is when the self realizes the highest Nibbana here and now. This refers to the second jhana. Another says to him, Sir, there is such a self as you say, but that is not when the self attains Nibbana. How so? Because on account of the presence of delight, there is mental exhilaration, and that state is considered gross. But when the self, with the waning of delight, dwells in equanimity, mindful and clearly aware, experiencing in his own body that joy which the noble ones say, happy dwells one who has equanimity and mindfulness, and so enters and abides in the third jhana. That is when the self realizes the highest Nibbana here and now. Stop here for a moment. So this refers to the third jhana. And you see, in this sutta, as in other suttas, in the third jhana, there is equanimity and mindfulness. Unlike what some monks say, that in state of jhana, there is no mindfulness. Here, there is equanimity and mindfulness. Another says to him, Sir, there is such a self as you say, I don't deny it, but that is not where the self experiences the highest Nibbana here and now. Why so? Because the mind contains the idea of joy, and that state is considered gross. But when, with the abandonment of pleasure and pain, with the disappearance of previous joy and grief, one enters and abides in the state beyond pleasure and pain, in the fourth jhana, which has utter purification of equanimity and mindfulness. The Pali is utter purification of equanimity and mindfulness. That is where the self realizes the highest Nibbana here and now. That is how some proclaim the highest Nibbana here and now for an existent being. I stop here for a moment. So here in this fourth jhana, the equanimity and the mindfulness is utterly purified. There is no higher equanimity and mindfulness than in the fourth jhana. This is what the sutta says. These are the five ways in which these ascetics and Brahmins proclaim a doctrine of Nibbana here and now. There is no other way. These monks, the Tathagata, understands, etc., etc. These are the 44 ways in which those ascetics and Brahmins who are speculators about the future, having fixed ideas about the future, put forward various speculative views about the future. There is no other way. This monks, the Tathagata, understands, etc. These are the 62 ways in which those ascetics and Brahmins who are speculators about the past, the future, or both, put forward views about these. There is no other way. This monks, the Tathagata, understands. These viewpoints thus grasped and adhered to will lead to such and such destinations in another world. This the Tathagata knows more, but he is not attached to that knowledge. And being thus unattached, he has experienced for himself the perfect peace. And having truly understood the arising and passing away of feelings, their attraction and peril, and their deliverance from them, the Tathagata is liberated without remainder. These monks are those other matters, profound, hard to see, hard to understand, peaceful, excellent, beyond mere thought, subtle, to be experienced by the wise, which the Tathagata, having realized them by his own super knowledge, proclaims, and about which those who would truthfully praise the Tathagata would rightly speak. Thus, monks, when those ascetics and Brahmins who are eternalists proclaim the eternity of the self and the world in four ways, that is merely the feeling of those who do not know and see, the worry and vexillation of those immersed in craving. When those who are partly eternalists and partly non-eternalists proclaim the partial eternity and partial non-eternity of the self and the world in four ways, that is merely the feeling of those who do not know and see, etc. When those who are finitists and infinitists proclaim the finitude and infinitude of the world on four grounds, that is merely the feeling of those who do not know and see, etc. When those who are ill wrigglers resort to evasive statements and wriggle like eels on foreground, that is merely the feeling of those who do not know and see, etc.